Association of Channell, the global head of alternative energy and clean tech from within the investment research division at Citi. I'm very excited to be moderating this panel with such an esteemed group of guests. The reasons I think it's such an exciting area is two main reasons. Firstly, I think we're seeing substitution and evolution within the energy space happening at a pace and to an extent that is absolutely unprecedented. Whether it's the US moving from sort of coal into gas by the advent of shale, or Germany moving from gas into solar, or Japan moving away from nuclear into things like solar. And as an example there, we saw Japan put about 8 gigawatts of solar in last year. And in context, that's about 8 nuclear power stations of peak output in the space of the space of 1 year, whereas it would take about 8 years to build one nuclear power station. So it's very, very exciting, all this pace of change. It's causing a lot of disruption within the industry. I think the second is simply the scale of the energy industry, and I think a lot of people who maybe aren't that close to the world of energy aren't aware of that, but it is the world's biggest industry. If we look at the amount of money which is going to be spent in terms of investment over the next 20 years, we're talking about $50 trillion. And if you think about actually what we're going to spend on energy in terms of fuel and investment over the next quarter century, we're talking about somewhere between 150 and 200 trillion dollars. So the sums of money are unimaginably large, and the change which is going on at the moment is of course leading to redirecting that investment into new technologies, new industries, new companies, new markets, and in different directions. I think that's what makes it so exciting, why I'm so excited to have this panel this morning. So I'd like to start just by going along, and if everybody could just introduce themselves very briefly in literally 1 or 2 minutes on the basis that we're a little pressed for time this morning. So no big long speeches, but just a little introduction about who you are, and then we'll get into it.
Okay, so I'm David Clark, I'm Chief Executive for the UK Energy Technology Institute. We're a public private partnership, UK government, big corporates, BP, Shell, E.ON, Rolls-Royce, and we carry out basically three activities: strategic analysis and planning around the UK energy system, much of that feeding into central government in terms of policy development. We carry out major financing for major R&D projects around low carbon energy systems. Finally, we have the commercialisation of new technology. And I guess I paraphrase what we do, and I don't say this in any bragging way, but people keep telling us, we only do difficult. If it's easy technology, then commercial investors, some of which are sitting to my left, will probably do it themselves off their own balance sheet. We get involved when it's very high risk, very difficult, and we try and march things through.
Thank you. So I'm Antoine. Rostand. I'm the founder of the Schlumberger Energy Institute, which is looking at the status of technology and R&D on all the technology related to the energy transition. So it's much broader than oil and gas. Our view today is that, as we know, CO2 certainly, represent around 60% of anthropogenic climate forcing. So it is really the number one target for climate change impact. And there are five main levers to reduce CO2. The first one, which represents around 39% of decarbonization potential, is efficiency. It's a number one fuel for the future. And our view in terms of technology that still much needs to be done today. There are a lot of effort done by developing countries, in particular in China, but OECD is improving, but at a pace which is not consistent with what we need to do. So efficiency, technology certainly are on top of the agenda. The second one is renewable, and the good news is really we are on track in terms of renewable in wind and solar, onshore wind and solar. Clearly, the industrial industrialization of PVs and wind makes this technology at grid parity, depending on obviously where it is and the radiation and wind. The problem with wind and solar is that it creates intermittency in the grid, which creates problem in itself. So there are a lot of problems and opportunities for technology in the grid, in the smart grid. And then it's booming, certainly in the Silicon Valley, so smart grid is hottest technology topics. And the next question is storage. And as a key technology shortage today in storage, it's hydrogen electrolysis. Hydrogen is certainly the best fuel for storage because you can transform electricity to hydrogen, hydrogen to electricity, to methane, to feedstock for petrochemicals. So hydrogen is a key fuel for storage, but today technology for electrolysis is not competitive, and it's a huge area of R&D target in the coming years. Then you have CCS. CCS is a great technology to sequester carbon. The trouble, it is not economic today because we don't have a price of carbon. So we need the price of carbon.
Do you mind if we come back to CCS a bit? I just wanted to go along the panel and get everybody to just introduce where they were to begin with, and then we'll actually get into some of the topics in a bit. And CCS was one that I wanted to come back to. So.
Good.
Hi, Simon Daniel from Moixa. We're an energy storage company. We've been putting energy storage across hundreds of houses on walls and aggregating this as a grid platform to shift from time of day production to evening and reduce peak. We're also very interested in energy finance, looking at how particularly one-tenth of pension bills goes into energy costs. And in the UK, with a $7 trillion pension liability, there's about $500 billion of the pension liability is actually future energy for household bills. And in recognizing that, we're developing models to address the post-subsidy regime and reduce fuel poverty to address your point about efficiency is a best form of investment and translates to a very good return for investors and pensioners. So we're both looking at the energy storage side as a technology, but also how to fund assets like that over time in homes and for systems.
Good morning, I'm Clark McFarlane. I run Siemens Wind Power and Renewables in the UK. Siemens, just so you're aware, I'm about to divide opinion, I guess, in the room, that 30% of wind turbines onshore and 80% of them offshore are a Siemens turbine. So if you don't like them, then you and I need to have a chat. Okay. So I quite often feel a bit pressurized. But on the wider Siemens scale, I've been in power engineering now for 33 years, and we produce about a third from our assets of the UK's electricity supply. About 30% of the transmission and distribution assets in the UK go through ourselves, and we have a portfolio for smart grid. So definitely energy is in our DNA.
I'm Alan Whitehead. I'm Member of Parliament, Southampton, and I'm also Shadow Energy Minister for Labour. My particular interest in this area, I think, stems from the politician's main imperative as far as energy is concerned, which is keep the lights on. And that has historically been almost exclusively carried out from a political point of view by assuming that demand is infinite and that what you're going to do is somehow ramp up the supply so that it meets the demand. We've seen in terms just recently the reports about the capacity crunch coming, which is essentially saying what is the maximum demand you're going to get over the next period and how much supply is there to meet that elastic demand. And my political interest is to flip that particular equation over and look at the ways in which we can, through storage, particularly in various other techniques, actually manage that that equation much more sensibly, but by the way, keeping the lights on in the process.
Wonderful. Well, thank you all. I mean, there are so many new technologies and changes going on out there, you know, whether it is CCS or solar or offshore wind or storage or, you know, and even the impact that things like electric vehicles are having, and home energy management systems, smart grid, smart appliances, etc. And we're seeing all of this integrated in a way that we've never seen before. I mean, if we can just go through the panel, and, you know, it is an innovations conference. If you can just say, you know, what you think the single most exciting thing over the next 10 years is going to be in the world of energy. David, if I can start with you.
So, no challenge then. The single most exciting thing. I hate to say this. If it can be cracked, cheap storage, I hate to say because you're sitting there, because you're saying, I've got the answer. But if it can be cracked, cheap storage is the game changer. Whether that's being applied to renewables, or whether it's being applied in terms of grid balancing and so on, frequency control, that's the game changer. And I think there's a challenge, which is many people have tried to develop storage technologies already. Most of them have gone bankrupt, okay? And they've done that for a number of reasons, one of which is technology turns out to be rather more complicated and expensive than they thought in the first place. The second one is, depending where you are, and my focus generally is UK, because that's kind of one I pay to worry about day in, day out. In a UK context, the market for storage is almost vanishingly regulated out of existence, almost, in the way it's structured. It's very, very difficult, particularly for small-scale storage. If you want to hollow out a mountain in North Wales and put a lake at the top and a lake at the bottom, then we have done that with great results, but it's quite an expensive thing to go and do, and there aren't very many mountains you can go and hollow out, practically anyway. So I think that's the kind of game-changing piece, but depending where you are in the world, it is more or less difficult to implement, and in some places it's going to be much simpler than in others. But linking clearly to renewables is a key opportunity there. So I think if you have the game changer, that's the one you're after. I think if you looked slightly more broadly and said, could I step back one from the game changer, then actually you suddenly open up, you know, a whole box of stuff at that stage, which will make enormous differences. And in the way that companies like Siemens and others are trying to pursue very much local scale, small scale energy storage, distributed storage, and so on, and change how the domestic consumer engages with the whole energy market potentially as a consequence. If you step back up to the major power plants and you look at the combined cycle gas turbines we've got around the UK, we've got nuclear plant, and so on. Once you get into that space, all of these things are going to be affected in how the system operates in the future, quite definitely. Just thinking about electricity for a second, they're all going to change. And the challenge there is, how do you make them operate efficiently and economically with more flexibility than they do today? So rather than have a gas turbine that runs optimally at 65% or whatever it is, and that's the position you always want to run it at, how do we make it so that you can operate more flexibly? And the answer may well be, you actually don't change the machine at all, but you need to put storage alongside it.
Yep.
And you're back with that kind of game. How do you run it flat out? And when there's demand, you take the power off it. And when there isn't demand, you dump it into a cheap store. And in that context, and I just one last one. So in that context, we're financing a company called Isentropic, who are developing, you know, basically that kind of storage system. And the trick there is not to try and store electricity, but they're storing heat rather than electricity. And heat can be used to moderate the power output of a gas turbine, for instance. So I think there's many ways of doing this, but, you know, if there's one game changer, then cheap storage is clearly going to be the game changer, but it is the ultimate holy grail, difficult one.
I'm guessing Simon is going to be storage, unless he's going to throw me completely and say CCS.
Yeah.
But
it's actually system. So it's a system approach, which storage is a key pillar, finance is a key pillar, efficiency is a key pillar. The energy system is the biggest machine in the country. It's one machine. It's like an old BMW. You've got to spend a lot of money keeping it going. $177 billion is the forecast number in the UK to keep the UK BMW going. If you take Germany as a ghost to Christmas future, it shows you what happens in 7 years' time when you stuff lots of renewables in the system. You get a lot of intermittency. You get negative prices intraday. Holland's very happy because it gets paid to take Germany's energy in the middle of the day. And that requires storage to shift energy around from night to day. But it is a system to link to the efficiency of it to make the thing work. The interesting thing about storage is it is managing distributed storage. If you put storage in the home, it's worth much more than putting it in the centre, because the home benefits, the utility benefits, the doors, the advanced management, the local network benefits, the local virtual curtailment benefits, as well as the aggregate pump, how hydro regulation in the UK is horrible because you have to contract each of these parties to get all the income, whereas other countries it's a bit easier or mandated. If I put a battery in a million homes, it looks like Dunoric. I can get the Dunoric income from the first time, Joe. I can also get the edge income from the household, from the solar, keeping energy local losses. Now, we've done a lot of work with that. What's also interesting is we've found lots of free batteries. So whilst chemistries have fallen at 9% a year, and actually about 20% per year in the last 3 years, partly because everyone's come out of the woodwork, and Tesla's shining the light on the industry, it will drop 67% by 2020 as an overall system, according to McKinsey. So it's getting better, but there's a lot of free batteries out there because there's lots of batteries in our devices. And we estimate there's maybe 200 to 300 megawatt hours of batteries charging electric vehicles a day, not for large. There's the same in mobility scooters. There's the same in electric bicycles. There's actually about 4 gigawatt hours a day, about 2 dinorics, charging daily in laptops. And so it's not very accessible, but if you could nudge through Internet of Things when things charge and move in a seamless way, it becomes quite interesting because most batteries in the world up until recently went into stuff, and that's available charged daily. An increasing small bit of the day is actually charged in your head, whether it's in your future robot, your Uber, your electric bicycle. In China, 150 million electric bicycles, about 40 to 50 gigawatt hours a day charging in electric bicycle fleets, which is about the same as wind curtailment for the country. And so if you could schedule that or have an autocratic thing, say these charge at this time, the curtailment in wind in China is actually about transmission line problems as well. It's energy in the wrong place in the country. Same as energy in Scotland is an excess of light from wind. So there's different problems, but actually storage and the free storage out there and managing all these things seamlessly is quite important, particularly when you recognise Internet of Things is 50 billion new things on the grid by early 2020s, and they're always on a peak, and you can't price change people to turn off their iPhones or turn off their television or turn off their internet. And so there's no behavioural change in this rising demand available unless you pre-charge them and move them around. And so that's an interesting problem because there is demand growth to stuff, electrification of heat, electrification of vehicles, and Google views exponential bandwidth, exponential demand for energy. We can't really get around that. We can move it around more efficiently and level, but it's a system approach, I think, is the critical thing. It's not just one technology. It's combining storage, finance, efficiency into a platform which levels the field is responsive to when people want to use energy.
Alan, what is it that you get most excited about?
Storage, and smart grids. One of the sort of quiet achievements we've done in this country is actually we have got, contrary to what you might read in the papers, rather a lot of renewables already on the system. About 8 gigawatts of onshore, 5 gigawatts offshore. And actually, by next year, there'll be about 10 gigawatts of solar on the system. And that actually puts us past the tipping point in terms of running the system in the traditional way. And yet, what we are currently proposing is not just a massive, great big nuclear power station at Hinkley C, but potentially a whole fleet of new gas-fired power stations over the next period, which will actually not use any of the advantages that actually having those new forms of energy on the system is going to produce. And so having effective storage, and I agree that has primarily distributed storage to take that demand off the central system, to actually make households and areas as potentially autonomous from the way the grid works, but having in conjunction with that, a much, much smarter grid. The grid, effectively at district network level, is operating on precisely the same principles as it operated 40 years ago, and mostly with the same equipment as it operated 40 years ago. So actually having a combination of much better storage to level out the supply, but also manage the grid much more effectively, combined with a smart grid system which actually manages what there is going around intelligently on two-way process, I think is going to transform how we manage our demand and supply in energy over the next period. and as soon as we get there, the better off we'll be.
Antoine?
So we plot individual technologies on a maturity curve, and there is one place where you don't want to be, which is the valley of death of technology. And the two most important ones today in the energy system is electrolysis for hydrogen, and I'll come back to that. And the second one is capture for CCS. So that are the two technologies which are today in the valley of death. So we know that if we can crack them, it will really be a game changer. Electrolysis, with that, you'll be able to take electricity at peak, at negative price or at peak, and then transform that into gas and methane, and you can store methane in the existing gas grid. So it's the storage tank exists. You can convert hydrogen into heat, into electricity, into methane, into feedstock for, it's really a perfect switching fuel. The trouble is electrolysis today, not for physical reasons, but just because we have not found the right chemical system to do electrolysis in an efficient manner is not economic. But the day this is cracked, it will really change all the economics around intermittency of renewables. So it's really electrolysis for hydrogen as a single technology. And then the CCS, it's capture. We know how to put carbon in the ground. You know, we have how to transport carbon. But capture today is too expensive. And for this, we need scale, we need project. And the only project today in CCS are linked to an oil and gas project. So there is revenue attached to CO2. In fact, CO2 in the US is very expensive. You have to buy $20 or $30 a ton. Then it makes injection of CCS interesting. But the capture is a single technology today, which is not master. We don't have scale, and which means that this technology today is in the kind of valley of death.
Clark, we can just bring you in a minute.
Well, I find myself agreeing with this end of the panel, actually. I'll try and bring a different argument than storage into it. So I'd rather talk about distributed energy and the translation from what we have today to what we need tomorrow. They said in the earlier panel that it takes 17 years to develop a technology. Well, that's not far off, because we know in energy systems it's plus 20, and we know from lithium batteries where we are today it's been 30. So we need a transition plan from where we are today to where we go tomorrow. And that's slightly more complicated, because we've talked about an electricity network, but we haven't talked about a gas network. And gas peak demand is 5 times electricity demand the way we are currently set up in the UK. So we have, at the moment, central systems. We know across the world that from September 2013, more people are living in urban areas than are living in rural areas. So therefore, we need a distributed energy system that's suitable for an urban area. And translating that is very difficult. And it depends what your driver is. Now, I'd like your driver to be CO2 reduction from my day job. It helps me. And I do think that's where the politicians are going to come from, as long as the lights stay on. Because as soon as the lights go off, they'll panic and they'll buy large CCGT or even open cycle gas turbines. So I think for me, it's storage, but it's storage taken into account urban population, don't forget the gas network, and don't forget we've got to translate maybe 10, 15 years before we get to the world that my colleagues are talking about here on the panel, and we need to keep the lights on in the meantime. So therefore, the holy grail storage in a distributed energy format, but we'll have more renewables with a mixed energy system until we get there, which is traditional technologies more efficient.
And in terms of, I was just thinking about some of the implications of all of this. If we're talking about distributed storage and distributed generation, you know, what does this mean for utilities and in terms of lower usage on grids and things like that? I mean, presumably huge implications.
The distributed assets really are a utility asset that needs to be managed by that intermediary on behalf of the customer. Best place to really manage storage. It should be financed by network operators and national grids, and the financing is a problem. But in the US, there's a company called Advanced Microgrid Solutions, which is sort of to manage storage as a utility class. And that's kind of a challenge to make sure that it is emerging. services business. GDF has acquired energy services businesses. The future utility model is not just energy supply, it's an energy service company and a finance company all in one.
Yeah.
I might explain to them to stop solving the problem by securitizing household incomes, because houses are not necessarily the best place to make technical choices. The utility is the best person to manage a system.
But isn't there a danger with this, that we come from this from the way that we've always done this, with big centralised generation and big utilities managing this? Whereas, you know, if you sort of pretend that none of that ever happened, right, and then we go 20 years into the future and we have houses with, it's not going to work everywhere, but solar panels on the roof, and you have a Tesla Powerwall, and you have a battery there, and your intelligent appliances, and you have rules which say, you know, my car can't discharge the less than 75%, I'll turn the appliances on, generate, store, sell back, buy back, and you have millions of electricity drivers. If you think what that does to load curves,
yes.
and you know,
it's definitely a distributed approach is key. However, the thing which is often overlooked is utilities. It's about persistency. And so Internet of Things is fast moving stuff, which is disposable hairs like mobile phones or apps or software, and slow moving stuff like appliances. And so utilities, where they're trusted, have a unique relationship of having term. They have assets over decades. So you need someone who's good at doing that. Android and iPhone will not exist in 2025, so you can't plan an infrastructure the way Siemens does, on the basis of software persisting in doing something slow like IBM Kix or Modbus. But if you want to run infrastructure, it's a slow data, multi-decade thinking thing. And so you need someone who's good at being utility over term. They have to acquire new skills and manage data clouds and service contracts. But the customer doesn't want to be left with a Nest thermostat in 2025 when Nest doesn't exist. So it's very different. If you think about broadband and how many routers people use in the last 10 days, if you think about hand and how many hands you have, there's a different type of thing you're trying to make it work over time to be constitute infrastructure, and definitely utilities sort of in their notional trust and term have a head start. And some of the thinking needs to be adopted, but to sort of, you know, to assume, and we've seen lots of utilities say, we need to be Airbnb and energy, not true. Because Hilton will be there in a decade's time, and Airbnb won't be there, and utilities will be there if they adopt some of this model, but you have to have a trusted term relationship to do the energy stuff well. And
I think, yeah, it's important when you look at this whole asset question, if just step back from it for a second and think, yeah, fine, so ultimate game-changing solution, world of the future, everything's distributed and so on. But what have we actually got now? And who's getting paid for it? So in simplistic, just look at this kind of simplistic numbers. There's a UK, just UK, gas pipes. There's a third of a million miles of gas pipes in Britain. There's a quarter of a million miles of electricity wires. Costing billions to put in. Power stations, round numbers, 100 power stations, okay? Average life on a power station, 60 years. So we've got these nice targets for 2050 of reducing carbon minus 80%. You make a decision now on a power station, that's it. You decide it. Between now and 2050, if it's a big power station, it will still be here. The costs are being amortised. It will be running. Unless somebody, sorry Alan, that means government, pay for it not to be running. Okay. So power stations, you've got basically one go at changing big power stations between now and 2050. What's the next one on your list? Well, power, heat, transport, and then the infrastructure. Heat, gas boilers, change them every 15 years. You've got three, maybe four goes between now and 2050. That's how fast we all change gas boilers. If I said to anybody in the room who's got a gas boiler, why did you change it the last time you changed it? I'm prepared to guarantee you will say, because it failed. It was not because I wanted a new one. I thought, oh, I have a more efficient version. It'll be because it went wrong, and you'll change it. Right? We don't change gas boilers. Motor cars, fleet rolls over every 10 years. You've got three changes of the UK car fleet between now and 2050. You know, again, I take your point, history. I'm talking about history, but this is what we all do. And then you kind of get down into some things that do start with a little bit quicker. Appliances and so on turn over every few years. But this point around the longevity of it and how long it takes to change it is a killer. And how long it takes to create new infrastructure And again, the lessons of history to some extent. We had a distributed gas network.
Right.
You go back to 1880, it was all distributed. It started in London, it started in Birmingham, local units that built out. It took about 25 to 40 years for them to become real big commercial units. It took 100 years before they all, well, not 100 years, but like 80 years before they all basically amalgamated into a single national network. And that was about the point when we all changed to natural gas. And about, looking around, probably 40% of the people in the room will remember somebody came into your house in the 1970s and changed all the burners in the cookers and all the burners in the boilers, if you had one, for something that would burn natural gas. Interestingly, just trying to pick up on your point, the gas network we had until the 1970s, the stuff that was in the pipes was, in round numbers, 50% hydrogen. That was what was in the pipes. It was town gas, it was manufactured, and it was about half hydrogen. The world today, yeah, if you look forward, one of the issues with having hydrogen-rich gas in your pipes, if they're metal pipes, the pipes end brittle. You don't want this. We've now got plastic pipes. We've got almost the perfect network for a high hydrogen-rich fuel. And the bit about storage, you can store energy in different ways. It doesn't have to be electricity. The gas network, you can pack it, you can compress what's in the pipe and create storage in the pipe. Superb solution, actually. So we've got 15 days in the gas pipes in Britain, ready to go. It's going to get burnt over the next 15 days, but there's more coming in. And the point about hydrogen is, yes, if we can get to electrolysis cheaply, it's a very neat way of just packing hydrogen into the pipes. And within reason, the system is ready to go. Leeds are doing all the modelling right now to do this, for real. They've modelled exactly which pipes they need to change. They've got it down to, I think, out of 3,000 kilometres of pipe in Leeds, they think they've got to change 160, which is what they change every year anyway. So the mechanism are rapidly coming there, but I think your point about the asset base, it is important to just look at the mindset and say, this stuff is all around us, we've spent billions of pounds on it, and somebody wants to recover their money. So there is a point that says, within reason, we are going to have to use it, certainly for the next 20 years, but I agree absolutely, the game-changing bit is what comes after that.
Well, I think it's
also, where do we go?
It's interesting as well whether you're talking about the UK or whether we're, you know,
I think UK all the time, I admit.
But it's, yeah. I think it's a fascinating analogy with kind of the telecoms industry, where if you look at emerging markets, where in the same way that the telecoms industry has leapfrogged fixed line, you know, straight to mobile, would you bother to build a grid in countries like India and link everything up?
Or absolutely. If you didn't have one, you might not start here.
No, exactly.
Unfortunately, or for good, we have.
But you have to look at the percentage of rural versus urban population. So, I mean, distributed works for rural household, which is a diminishing part of population in any case. Obviously, distributed system is perfectly targeted to reduce energy poverty in Africa and India. I mean, this is really targeted for, you know, it's easy to create a small system in a village, and you need, something like 60 watts per household, so you will have enough, you know, power to just get people out of energy poverty. But in terms of volume, it's completely different from the energy uses that we have in the West. So you have to really differentiate between rural and urban population in any case.
Alan, I think you wanted to come in. I think perhaps from a political point of view, a point I think we need to be clear about is we are actually in that stranded asset hiatus right now.
We are.
It's not a question of thinking, well, what are we going to do in the future? And maybe we can run the system as it is, and then we decide whether we have a heap of new power stations or not. Before our eyes, a number of gas-fired power stations are being mothballed. The claim is that that's about energy prices and spark spread at the moment. But also, new CCGT power stations are at the moment completely uninvestable. And again, that's not just because of the present price and spark spread hiatus, but also because looking forward, precisely that projection, even in terms of what we have on the system already, means that those power stations would not recover their investment on the basis of running on the assumption of 65%, because the projection is they'll be running at more like 20% over the next period as backup to the system. And so, to some extent, the choices are being made for us as we look ahead. And to my mind, the problem we've actually got is that in terms of planning, we're looking at the future as it looked like 20 years ago. Remember those films where everybody is looking very futuristic, so they've got massive, like, big telephones and banks of computers. That seems to me where we are in energy policy right this minute. And for example, storage. The question on storage, to some extent, yes, it is getting the technology to right to a great extent, but actually how you incentivize storage within the system by having to make assumptions about where the points of incentivization are that actually bear no relation to the traditional way that we've been doing things, like grants and feed-in tariffs and various things such as that. If you can capture the benefit from the difference in prices at different times of the day, that storage, among other things, can smooth out and put that back into storage. It needs no subsidy at all, provided you can regulate so that that happens.
I just want to pull Clark in.
Can I just bring up your point on utilities? Because most of us who maybe don't have solar panels on our roof or some sort of micro generation in our back garden, we're paying for our energy supplies. And you said, what is their future? And I think that's fairly straightforward, because we've seen the utilities in my lifetime go from 1 CGB down to 3, to 12, up to 42, down to 6, and they've got a consumer base. And as long as we get the technical, so the volts and amps and frequencies correct, that we can keep the appliances, whatever we go, correct, then I believe that a model will arrive. And we've seen it in renewables, where we've got developers coming in. And as long as they've got the power purchase agreements, as long as they've got an infrastructure system, as long as they're supplying it to grid parity, then there isn't a problem. So I don't think that's a big issue. The only issue I think we've got, and interest analysis is we've given out all these hundreds of thousands of contracts to households and individuals that are getting the models of payment for their own electricity. And that's in a rather uncontrolled manner, and the utilities have got a requirement to buy the excess. And I think that's the problem we've had with lots of distributed generation, is what onus are you going to put, or what responsibility are you going to put on those utilities, which might affect their business models. And therefore, you do end up with the potential of that being a premium to take that price, and that would slow down the advancement of any distributed energy or local generation.
I'd like to open it up to the floor now, in the interest of time as well. So if we have got a few questions out there from the floor. Come on here at the front.
I'd like to ask the panel two questions. First of all, in a low-carbon future, what is the role of fossil fuels like oil and gas? And what is the long-term plan for handling civilian waste?
Anybody want to take it?
So, you know, I mean, in oil and gas, you know, the size of the infrastructure, the sunk cost of having an infrastructure that is that enables our way of life, you know, Western way of life is based on cheap energy. In all scenario, it is here to stay. The question is really more, if you want to decarbonize, how you reduce the carbon footprint. And the key today is fuel switching between coal and gas. So, you know, it's more by adjusting the mix between oil, which is predominantly economic today only for transportation, gas and coal, and by switching from coal to gas, there is a very quick impact on emission of carbon. So it's certainly a transition before going to more renewable in the mix.
Oil and gas is a huge percentage in this diagram. It's not going to change very quickly. I think the nuclear thing is very interesting. Had we done more nuclear, we would have a lot of carbon environment today. A lot of nuclear innovation happening in California, sort of mini fusion level or the mini nuclear level. So they haven't quite called it a company called Bloom, which feels like they haven't quite called the new company Boombox for nuclear, but I expect the sort of mid-century stuff will be driven by nuclear innovation. So I'm quite optimistic as a technologist for the mid-century stuff. I'm also slightly suspicious about, I kind of like the idea of excess carbon, because we need all the carbon to make nanotech. And so if you have a carbon capture technology which delivers carbon materials, then there might be a symbiotic system. I think the pressing thing about your waste comments is there's a lot of human waste at the street level, and our waste society, so the innovations around waste to energy, maybe at the urban level, are important because we produce all this stuff, and there's a lot of energy in that waste, and it's not being properly captured and turned into urban energy. And I think that's an area where we're very bad about waste in the short term. And long term, I agree there's nuclear issues, but actually the short term waste problem is more significant and an opportunity for energy.
Well, I think we've got to be a little bit careful about the extent of the transition of coal to gas, because certainly if we in this country, if we replaced what is a coal energy economy very much on the way out exclusively with gas over the next period, yes, we'd make a substantial hit in the short term, but actually we'd still install well above our carbon targets a system which wouldn't get us anywhere near, and indeed the idea that we might get our energy supplies down to 100 grams of emissions kilowatt hour by 2030, if we go for a new gas program, even if it's better than coal, we'd still be way out of that target. And my view is that the only role for fossil fuels in the system over the period 2030 plus would be on the basis of CCS, whether it's gas or coal, and that's why I think that technology is so important right now, because we are going to need those forms of fuel inputs, but they've got to be decarbonised in line with our targets, and not sitting there avoiding our targets.
Yeah, I think that's the absolute crux issue, is how we implement CCS in the UK, because it's vitally important to not underestimate the importance of fossil fuels in terms of flexibility, security, availability, price. All of those factors say these fuels are vitally important to any nation in terms of their energy infrastructure and pricing. But the reality is, from a UK perspective, all the analysis we've done says meeting the 2050 targets without being able to use fossil fuels with carbon capture and storage, you double the cost to the country of delivering those 2050 targets. It's that simple. It goes from 1% of GDP to 2% of GDP, which in terms of household bills means £1,000 by 2050, £1,000 on every household's energy bill for a year. That's what it's going to cost if you don't have carbon capture and storage. So it does become vital, and it becomes vital to progress it quickly, because if you think you can't do it, as Alan said, you need to start implementing other things in the next 10 years. And those other things are more expensive. So it requires a fair degree of forethought for this stage. So it's a crucial one to get right, to get it developed now, and the demonstrators that UK government is planning to back here in the UK, you know, it's important we get those going ahead in the next 12 months.
So I'd agree with that, but I'd like to just throw in another factor, which was, I agree with, I think coal has to go out, I think oil and gas has a place, but I would challenge why we need to use burning too much oil, too much gas for energy production, because I think there are better places for us to use it within our economy. So, for example, I talked earlier that heat, we've not talked about heat, it's five times the demand of electricity. That's where, you know, I'd rather use our gas, because it'd be very difficult to change the whole gas infrastructure you talked about and all the households. So we've got to be very careful about a reliance on gas for energy production. And if I look at oil, then one of the things we managed to do is decarbonise quite significantly, particularly in the UK, but also in Europe, our energy production. But we've not done the same with our transport infrastructure. And so we're behind on our CO2 reduction plans for our transport infrastructure. And if you go to the airline industry, they tell you that the last drop of oil will be put in a plane. It won't be used to do energy production. And so therefore, one of the ways of doing it is to change the fuel we've got. So, for example, if you were at the airline industry at the moment, they're looking at organic crops to grow their oil. And some of their technology is looking at different organic crops. So at the moment, it would need the whole of France to grow organic crops. What do you think, that's a good use of France or not? To grow all the crops required to fly all the planes. The technology you're looking at the moment would only need the whole of Belgium, which you might prefer. But you see, that technology might allow us oil in a different substance to use in transportation, which would then free up energy production. So I don't think we can ignore the requirements for the fuels in other industries.
Not to mention green gas.
Now, I'm very conscious that we're in between you and your coffee, I think it might be better in the interest of time for we actually take the questions while we're milling around over coffee, because I'm sure there's... I could certainly go on asking questions all day long. But my sincere thanks to all of our panelists and to you for listening.